welcome to all of you here this morning and those of you that are at home watching. It's so nice to see you all here. Actually, I was starting to worry. The numbers were going down and down after every week. And then I thought, okay, they want to get rid of me. That's quick. But anyway, the numbers are up this morning, I can tell, by even just looking around, and that's wonderful. Should I ask if there's been anything exciting happening this week? Yes, it was. Yes, it was. Reverend Rob's birthday, yes. I called him and wished him a happy birthday, and so did Paul. It was that boop sound that did it. Anyway, he was advising me that this isn't his, wait till I get it out of my mouth. Next week isn't his first week back. He won't be back till the 5th of September. So that's fine, but it did take us all off guard because I'd been told that he was going to be back next week. Anyway, I'm so glad to see you all here. No anniversaries, no birthdays, none of that besides Rob?
My granddad's going to be a year old on Tuesday.
Wonderful. Wow, very good. Now, come on, there's got to be more good news than this. Did you pick apples or tomatoes or... Tomatoes, okay. Rhubarb, it's almost over. Okay, well, whatever. Glad you're here this morning. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth stand silent before him. But worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him. O God, make speed to save us. Make haste to help us. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And now we invite Paul. Are you having trouble with the organ this morning, Paul? See, we got to get a new organ. The opening hymn is Christ Has Made the Sure Foundation. Almighty and most merciful Father, grant to your faithful people merciful pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our psalm this morning is Psalm number 84, and we will say it by alternate verses. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts! My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God. Other side of your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you. Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way. Those who go through the desolate valley will find it a place of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water. They will climb from the height to height, and the God of gods will reveal himself in Zion. Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Hearken, O God of Jacob. Behold our defender, O God, and look upon the face of your anointed. For one day in your courts is better than 1,000 in my own room, and to stand at the threshold of the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is both sun and shield. He will give grace and glory. No good thing will the Lord withhold from those who walk with integrity. O Lord of hosts, happy are they who put their trust in you. And together our psalm prayer, God of pilgrims, help us to worship you in our response to those who need our care. For all the world is your temple, and every human heart is a sign of your presence, made known to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The reading this morning is from John's Gospel, chapter 6. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them, just as the living Father sent me. And I live because of the Father. So whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe, and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, 'For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father.' Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, 'Do you wish also to go away?' Simon Peter answered him, 'Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God.'" The Gospel of Christ. Our hymn now is "Here I Am, Lord."
I'm
words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. The one-time president of the United States, whom we all know, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, often endured long receiving lines at the White House. He frequently complained that no one really paid any attention to what he said. So one day during a reception, he decided to try an experiment. To each person who came down the line and shook his hand, he murmured, "I murdered my mother-in-law this morning." The guests responded with phrases like this: "Marvelous, keep up the good work, we're proud of you, God bless you, sir." It was not until the end of the line, while being greeted by the ambassador from Bolivia, that his words were actually heard. Not quite knowing what to say, the ambassador leaned over and whispered, "I'm sure she had it coming." In John 6, in one of the most amazing scenes in Scripture, Jesus feeds the multitude. We've been reading a lot about Jesus' miracles in the last few weeks. The miracle of the loaves and fishes had a tremendous impact on the followers of Jesus. The impact of that event on the multitude was enormous. They knew someone special was in their midst, and they wanted to make him king. When Jesus saw that they were getting carried away in their response to this event, he retreated across the Sea of Galilee to his home in Capernaum. Now, I'm going to just stop for a moment here and remind you, if you've had the opportunity, the wonderful chance to go to the Holy Land, you're going to get a real awakening about the way things are, as opposed to what we might have thought they were. For an example, the Sea of Galilee is really only a small lake. And his home in Capernaum, or Capernaum as we would say it, the Jewish people actually say Capernaum. But I'll keep saying Capernaum because everybody knows it that way. So he went across the sea, or the lake, to the other side. And people came looking for him even there. So Jesus knew they had come to find him because they had been impressed with the miracle of the loaves and fishes. And so he decided to separate the sheep from the goats, the highly committed from the casually interested. When Jesus began discussing what we know as the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, it was not a popular subject for after-dinner conversation. The people who heard it didn't know him, know what he was talking about, and they were repulsed by the imagery. After all, he seemed to be talking about his disciples eating his body and drinking his blood. What is this, the people wondered? The plot of a vampire movie? I don't think they thought that at that time. There were no movies, just in case you know. That's good. What is this, the people wondered, of the plot of the vampire movie? The sounds more pagan than religious, eating his body, drinking his blood. They didn't get it, and they were disappointed. Now, you may remember from listening to the gospel this morning that he talks about his disciples. The disciples he's talking about are the followers, those people who are following him, not the 12. Sometimes it gets a little confusing because we think of the 12 as the disciples, but we're all disciples. And so he's talking about the people who had been up to this point following him because of all his marvelous works. They wanted him to set forth his economic policy as their new king, how he was going to give them anything they wanted and needed without raising their taxes. That's what they were looking for. They weren't much different than people today. They wanted the benefits, but not the cost. Jesus wanted them to know that the easy part was over. The easy part was over. Now it was time to tackle the nitty-gritty of what a commitment to this kingdom meant. And most of the crowd would have nothing to do with it. In verse 66, we read these words, "From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him." I wonder, would we be any different today? Those are important words. "From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him." And some of you have been through difficult times in recent years with health problems, family problems, business problems. Life hasn't followed the rosy scenario that you once thought it would. Some of you have maybe even felt your faith weaken. But Jesus understands. After he fed the 5,000 people who were going to make him king, their enthusiasm was dimming rapidly, and they turned away. This, my friends, was the turning point in Jesus' life and ministry. He knew, of course, that it would happen this way, but still, it must have been disappointing for him. The gospel reading today comes from John's gospel, and the section is headlined, "Jesus, Bread of Life." It is from this chapter that we derive our practice of the Eucharist, or Holy Communion. The Church recognizes the Eucharist as the most important aspect of our Christian faith. It's considered so important that we Anglicans celebrate Holy Communion almost every week, along with our Roman Catholic, Lutheran, and Orthodox brethren. Chapter 6 of John's Gospel tells us they grumbled, they mumbled, they argued, they whined, and ultimately they left in droves. I want you to put yourself in this story. If you had been present when Jesus spoke to his followers, which are referred to in this scripture as disciples, how would you have reacted? Well, it reminds me of the comments that I've made a few times before, and I'm sure you all agree. If Jesus was to come down to earth today, walk into this room and say, "I am Jesus, the Christ," how would we react? How would we react? I'll bet dollars to donuts we do the same darn thing that they did on Good Friday many, many years ago. We'd laugh, we'd reject, we wouldn't believe, because we have to see something fantastic happen before we will believe. We can't believe or have a hard time believing what we can't see. Jesus said, "Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and for my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink." I know that you and I think in the normal way of a human being that this is incredible and unbelievable. We too would probably abandon him. He said several things which confused some and upset others. "I am the bread of life," he said. Some objected to this language because they believed he was comparing himself to Moses. Remember, these people are all Jewish. Jesus wasn't a Christian. Jesus was a Jew, and he's talking to these Jews. So they were thinking that he was trying to compare himself to Moses. And we all know the story of Moses and how he led the people out of Egypt. Moses gave them manna, that is to say, through God, in the desert, in the wilderness. But Jesus took it a step farther and said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. And this appeared odd to some, because they knew he was the son of Mary and Joseph, a carpenter, and not some modern-day Elijah sent from heaven back down to earth. It just sounded weird and crazy. So then you can understand why in verse 66 of chapter 6, we read that many of his disciples left him. I don't think there's a single reason as to why so many stopped following him. It's more likely a combination of issues. If I've already noticed, I've already noted that his teaching confused some. His images offended others. But primarily, I think it was his claim to be the source of a new life, and that he claimed to be greater than Moses. How could this upstart be greater than Moses? They weren't buying it, and they left, just like that, because they didn't understand what Jesus was really trying to say. This teaching moment has to do with how we interpret Jesus' teachings about his body and his blood. John's gospel is the only one of the gospel that talks about Jesus' body and blood. This is the issue which caused much dissension in the church. And by church, I mean the original church as Jesus meant it to be. Anglicans believe that when the bread and wine are consecrated, it represents Christ's body and blood. This process generally means that his body and blood are symbolically present in the bread and the wine. We don't believe, as the Catholics do, or the Roman Catholics do, that it's transubstantiation, that it actually becomes blood and body. We believe it's present. His presence is spiritually in the body and blood. So he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So what's the bottom line of this gospel passage? I believe that it means if we embrace Jesus' teachings totally, that we will see him as he actually is. That is, he is truly God incarnate. It's a whole lot easier for us to understand that today in 2021 than it was in 30 AD. Listen again to maybe the most beautiful and meaningful words in the Bible. And it's something that I really emphasize in a funeral that I conduct. It gives the person who's had the loss comfort in knowing that we are not dead forever, that we live on in the Spirit that dwells within us. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. Isn't that incredible? Live forever in the Spirit, not in these earthly bodies, because they just deteriorate and cause us nothing but grief. Hips and knees and, you know, all of those things. So hopefully, when we pass, we will live comfortably in the presence of our Lord Jesus the Christ. From this passage, I believe that if we could ever develop this hunger for the body and blood of Christ, it would be satisfied. And in that satisfaction, we might discover what it is we have been searching for, and that is eternal life. Think about it for a second. How long are we here on earth? It's not even a drop in the bucket. It's not even a sprinkle of water. We're here for such a small time. And we hang on to it like it's the only thing to be. But it's only the beginning of something wonderful. We go to see and meet our Lord when we pass. And nothing that we have ever done or will do will take away that which Jesus has promised us. Eternal life through my body and blood. If our faith is not based on eternal life, or if you like, the life hereafter, that there's no point in being a Christian. Amen. Come on, give them a clap. It's always so wonderful hearing Diane and Vicky do a duet. I think that's wonderful. Thank you, ladies, and thank you, Paul and Karen. Before we start the prayers of the people, I would like you to take a few seconds to silently think about those people who you love, the people in the world that need us, those poor souls overseas that are gradually being gotten out of the turmoil of Afghanistan. Think about all those people who you care about in your heart. For this holy gathering, for the people of God in every place, and for all who seek the Lord, Lord, have mercy. For mercy, justice, and peace among all people, Lord, have mercy. For students and teachers and all those returning to their studies, Lord, have mercy. For abundant fruits of the earth and for safety from violent storms, Lord, have mercy. For the sick and the suffering, travelers and those on vacation, prisoners, captives, and their families, and all those in danger and need, Lord, have mercy. For our city of Woodstock and those who live in it, and for our families, companions, and all those that we love, Lord, have mercy. For those who rest in Christ, and for all the dead, Lord, have mercy. Lifting our voices with all creation, with St. Bartholomew, Monica, mother of Augustine of Hippo, Augustine, bishop of Hippo, and all the saints, let us offer ourselves and one another to the living God through Christ, to you. And now, for those members of our congregation who are ill or in need of our prayers, Marjorie, David and Doreen, Jean, Pat, and for anyone else that you have in your mind, in your heart, that you think we should pray for, either silently or aloud. Charles. For those candidates who are running for federal office. We pray to you, O Lord, for the well-being of these, our brothers and sisters in Christ. And now our hymn, How Clear Is Our Vocation.
Thank you.
Please join me in the collect of the day. Almighty God, we are taught by your word that all doings without love are worth nothing. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, the true bond of peace and of all virtue. Amen. And now, as our Lord taught us,
thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Very nice. Sight reading? Hey, that's pretty good for sight reading, wouldn't you say? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and always. Amen.